Hi, everybody. Welcome back to ASIS Security Snapshots. I'm your host, Chuck Harrell. Today's topic, COVID-19 and retail crime trends with my guest, Basia Pietrawska. She's the Vice President of Consulting and Analytics at CapIndex. Ms. Basia, welcome to the show, my friend.
Thank you for having me.
Now, I'm excited to speak to somebody from CapIndex. CapIndex is the OG, right, of crime analysis. I had your maps, was it 20 years ago, 30 years ago? Well, who better to talk to about COVID-19 retail crime trends, because you are the guys that invented trends. What changes in retail violent crimes have you seen in 20 and 21? Don't tell me about 2022 yet, because that's going to make me too nervous. But COVID has changed everything. It's kind of nutty, isn't it?
It absolutely has. I mean, 2020, as soon as all the restrictions started and the stay-at-home order was introduced, we saw a lot of change. And obviously, some of that change was actually good because people were simply not out there, including the criminals. So we did see a significant decrease initially in persons crimes and a lot of property crimes. But at the same time, because a lot of retail locations were closed and they remained closed for a couple of months, we did see a very significant increase in burglaries. I mean, some of the numbers basically doubled when compared to 2019. So that was really one of the major differences that we saw initially. And then as the year progressed and we got into the civil unrest issues that started in June and then continued to see more of an increase in property crime. So burglary continued to escalate, theft, arson, vandalism continued to escalate due to those incidents. So that was a pretty dramatic increase as well. And then as the different retail locations continued to open up, we started to see an increase in some of the persons crimes. So especially aggravated assaults. As we know, the pandemic caused a lot of tension. People were more agitated. A lot of people lost sources of income. So we started to see an increase in those assaults and even some robberies and other types of violence. When it comes to simple assaults, which is, of course, another important type of an assault, we actually saw a decrease. But I actually suspect a lot of it was due to the fact that those are less serious in nature. And police don't simply respond to them as much. The same thing could be said about shoplifting. When I look at 2020, I do see a significant decrease in shoplifting for a lot of the locations that remain closed. But I also know in working with retailers from California, for instance, police just simply didn't respond to those incidents. So that was quite frustrating for the retailers that operate in those settings. When I look at shoplifting, though, for locations that remained open, so drugstores, convenience stores, obviously they continue to operate, or grocery stores, I'm actually seeing a slight increase in shoplifting during the pandemic. And a lot of it, again, is because they operated, so criminals shifted from other targets that were closed to those retail locations that actually remained open. And then as we continued into the end of 2020 and then the first 6 months of 2021, we're definitely seeing a decrease in burglaries. So we're sort of back to the pre-pandemic levels with that. At the same time, we're unfortunately continuing to see an increase in violence. And that is something that isn't just for retail. We're seeing that for a lot of industries. We're seeing a lot of media reports of increases in shootings across different cities in the United States. And some of that, unfortunately, does translate into retail locations. A lot of it is buried within that aggravated assault category, where if there's the use of a weapon or shooting, that's going to go into that category. And again, unfortunately, we're seeing that increase. And I think some of it is, again, related to various tensions associated with the pandemic, mask wear enforcement, some locations are starting to check vaccination status. All of that, I think, is contributing to the overall level of violence that we're seeing right now.
I would categorize these things as robberies, because if five or six people rush into a store and I'm fearful and I can't act to stop you, fear is a component of robbery. So do we think there's kind of not a misclassification, but a different classification? You know, when you think about retail crime, you think about grand theft or petty theft. But really, you know, somebody, a mob coming into a store stealing things, that's a robbery. when a mob comes in together, that's a burglary, right? So are these numbers and stats being categorized differently as class one crimes for some reason?
That is absolutely a possibility. In working with many retailers and also police departments, I find this issue all the time. There's always that sort of blurry line between theft and robbery. In fact, I was actually on a call a few days ago with a retailer where that came up, and I realized they were classifying a lot of their thefts as robberies. So I think we'll never really fully have an answer as far as these statistics will be close, but I think we have to assume that some thefts end up in the robbery category and then vice versa. And I think the goal, now with things changing so much with COVID and criminals also changing their tactics, it might be very important to take a look at these definitions and really strive as a group to classify them consistently, because that's really the only way for one retailer to compare their experience to another retailer. And I know that's always the question that I get from our clients. How does my experience compare to others? And if we're not going to have consistent definitions, then we won't be able to answer this question properly.
Well, exactly, especially in places like California, where they've literally changed the laws. And when I looked at the title here before we spoke, retail crime trends, my thought was, but there's no crime. It's not a retail crime because they've kind of gotten rid of crime as a definition. You know, oh, if it's under $900, it's not a crime. It's kind of, oh, it just hurts my head. Let's talk about changes in retail property crime. So a lot of buildings are empty for a long time. A lot of businesses have closed. A pharmacy in San Francisco, a major pharmacy chain, is closing down because of the things that are happening. So tell us about the property crimes as opposed to the, crimes against persons, I suppose.
Yeah, we saw a massive increase in burglaries, just really purely because locations were closed. So when looking at, let's say, restaurant crime compared to retail crime, I saw almost a displacement where these criminals clearly started to move away from other businesses, other types of locations towards retail, because that was just such an easy target with locations being closed. So that was definitely a big issue last year. This year, we're starting to see a decrease, or we have seen a decrease for a while now, which is good. But again, it's really a function of locations being more open now. We are also seeing quite a significant number of vandalism cases. So that is something that has been an issue for multiple industries. And I know one potential reason for that is related to vagrancy, homeless population issues. So that's another big subject, sort of in the context of crime, but also going beyond crime, that became an issue in 2020 and continues to be a big issue in 2021. So I think it's important to continue to explore that and understand that. And I think one issue there is that police do not always respond to vagrancy-related issues. So I know retailers are struggling with that. So that's going to continue to be a big subject of conversations moving forward.
Now, we've been speaking about traditional retail crimes in a non-traditional way. Would you categorize things like cyber retail crime, fraud, and supply chain crime, because your supply chain feeds the retail business? Are we looking at stats for those things, and do they tie somehow into this other trend of all these, you know, COVID-related things?
Yes, we have been looking at fraud incidents for retail. That one is tricky because the fraud category isn't always tied to the physical location of a store. So that gets tricky to identify in terms of trends. But if anything, it's something that surprised me. I'm finding a decrease in fraud-related incidents. I actually expected more of an increase. One could assume that if a physical location, physical target is not as available, criminals would switch more towards cybercrime. So I'm not sure if it's a reporting issue or if there are any other issues there. That sort of came up in my speculations in conversations with retailers. And again, I should clarify, everything that I'm talking about is crime that is actually reported to police department. So
good point.
Underreporting is probably a big factor here.
And the supply chain, is the supply chain something that is tracked differently? Because I worry about the supply chain more than I worry about anything people are talking about. Because if you break some of those parts, we start losing food, we start losing resources and things that keep people alive. I think it's a really serious issue.
It is definitely a serious issue. But the one issue that I struggle with, again, when looking at data for supply chain, underreporting again.
Oh, okay.
based on what I've seen from all the examples I've looked at so far, a lot of issues there. So I can't really answer this question with confidence, but we know there's definitely an issue there. Another aspect that I guess we should mention is also package theft, because everything is now switching to delivery.
Oh, yeah.
That's something that I think a lot of us need to remember. And really, it's if a package gets stolen, who is liable for that? And even though you have third parties involved in delivering, it's the retailer ultimately that sort of their reputation ends up being affected. So I think that's where a lot of potential losses lie as well.
Excellent, excellent point. Now, what can we expect moving forward when it comes to retail crimes? Don't make me too depressed, all right? I'm not liking these trends too much. It seems like it's a cycle we're not going to be able to get out of unless there's a major shift in willpower to change some of this legislation and social behavior. It's really troublesome. What's going on in 2022 that we can worry about?
Yeah, I think you said it right. I think some bigger changes need to be made so that we can get out of this really concerning trend. Unfortunately, based on what I'm seeing, just studying statistics for each quarter of the year as we go on, we are seeing some concerning increases in crime. That goes both for property crime and, more importantly, violent crime. And that is the biggest concern. So unfortunately, based on the trends so far, my prediction is that we're going to continue to see an increase. And keep in mind that as we're getting into the holiday period, that is where we really start to see crime spike for a lot of reasons. So that is something that we'll unfortunately have to keep in mind, at least for the remainder of the year.
Basia Pietrawska, she's the Vice President of Consulting and Analytics for CapIndex, a legacy company. Been around a long, long time, kind of invented this crime index stuff back in the old days with maps and the old physical world. I'm really happy you came on and told us about this. I think a lot of people need to pay attention to this, even if you're not in retail, right? Because I think there's going to be a trickle-down effect to other businesses that involve non-retail crimes. So thanks so much for coming on ASI Security Snapshots, and good luck to you.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.